project on promoting justice. So what was important for that project is that it looked at frontline police officers. Now, why frontline police officers? Because it's mainly because they're usually the people who investigate the first, who conduct the first investigative interviews, and usually at the scene. So it is extremely important for them to use the best practices. Now, unfortunately, what happens in practice is that they don't really have proper training, and they only get at best a few days of training, and that's it. And obviously, with the upcoming modernization and digitization of the investigative interviewing, this creates some advantages, but also disadvantages. So, for instance, the fact that the pathways to justice are quicker and more effective is obviously an advantage. But clearly, the fact that all the interviews are available, video recorded and audio recorded, means that any minor lapses in best practices are more exposed. So that was the reason that it was extremely important to create some sort of clear structure for the police interviewing training. Before the project started, and the first phase of the project, the colleagues from Goldsmiths University examined baseline performance. And what they found out is that very often what happens is that, for instance, in 82% of cases, there was no attempt to build rapport with the witness or victim, and the use of questioning techniques was very poor, so overuse of closed questions, and generally the interviews were interviewer-led rather than interview-led, just as we have talked between the Mary Ellen, we know how important it is to have the whole interview led by the interviewee themselves. Now, what is the structured interview protocol? The most important thing is that it's consistent with peace interview template, and it only adds some new techniques. The new techniques that are supposed to help the police interviewers follow the peace template. So, for instance, for the first phase of engage and explain, they had a list of different features to add to build rapid rapport skills, a use of empathy, incorporate threshold, incorporate conditions for setting threshold reporting and source monitoring and so on, and for the and also to use techniques to facilitate memory retrieval. So appropriate use of questions, but equally interviewing that interviewing techniques and use of self-generated cues. To give some examples after the SIP protocol was introduced, they developed training. Now there were three phases. In the first phase, which started before the training, all the officers interviewed the mock witness. In total, there were 65 response officers from two UK police forces. So before they started the training, they interviewed the mock witness, then they had the training, or techniques, for a day, and after that, they interviewed a different mock witness about a different crime. So we've got data before the training and after the training. What is interesting, though, is that forensic psychologists from Goldsmiths University only transcribed the questions and not the answers. From the linguistic point of view, it kind of misses, in a way, misses the point, because you only have the questions, and the questions are obviously, so only half of interaction is present, and half of interaction, the most important part of interaction, is missing. But that's what they had. That's what they used to evaluate the training and the effectiveness of training. So just to give you an idea on the original method that was used, they used coding sheets, and on each coding sheet there were 54 categories. So you can imagine with that amount of interviews, there's 130 interviews. They wanted to go through all of the interviews and code all of them according to these 54 categories. So just to give you an example, this is one of the first tables that they filled in. And it starts with some fairly straightforward questions, like for instance, whether the police interviewer asks for the name in an attempt to build rapport. But as we move down the list, the questions and categories become more subjective. So rapid rapport techniques used or using empathy where applicable. How do you coach for empathy? This could be very subjective. Another one, explanation, whether the explanation of the whole procedure was provided or not. Again, some of the categories are pretty straightforward. So providing reasons for discussion is clarified, or the explanation for taking notes is provided. That is, yeah, pretty straightforward. But then, for instance, one of the other tables that they filled in was on questions, and different types of questions, and functions of questions. And this is where it really gets tricky. So what we suggested is to use an alternative method and to use focus linguistic techniques. So we'll present that down. Yeah.
Okay, so some of you in here will be very familiar with course linguistics, I'm sure. Some of you will be hearing about it for the first time. So given by mischief's the level, exactly. But basically, a corpus is a database of texts, a digital database of texts. So the texts that we're using are the transcripts of the interviews. So 65 transcripts from before the training and 65 transcripts from after the training are split into two separate data sets. And we're going to compare those against each other. Corpus linguistics offers a data-driven bottom-up approach. It has the potential to be more objective. In this case, you can see there's still a lot of interpretation required of the results, but it provides a method of sort of pointing you in a direction of things to investigate within your data collections. And one of the simplest sort of starting points of the tools that you can use for the field is word frequency lists. So you can summarize all of those transcripts into a list of words and the frequency with which they occur within them. And then you can use that to move on to slightly more advanced techniques, such as keywords. So here we can compare the frequencies of those words in the before corpus and the after corpus. So in the transcripts before the training and the transcripts after the training. And we can use a significance measure to determine which words are significantly used more in one corpus than the other. So this is the kind of results that you get from that. In the middle here you have the frequency of the word in one corpus and the frequency in the other corpus, and they're compared together using a significance measure to generate a keener score. And on the left hand side of the screen you're seeing the words that are being used in the transcripts before the training. On the right hand side the words that are being used in the transcripts after the training. And the first thing that you sort of see in this view of the data is that lots of nouns and adjectives are being used in the interviews beforehand. So and these are from the officer's questions, so they are describing the events themselves, possibly. And in the after transcripts, you see some of the highlighted words here which relate to building rapport and more interviewee-led techniques, which is good. That's the kind of thing we want to see coming out of the training. And so we can go through these in a bit more detail and sort of use some of these words as pointers for further investigation. So you see, classify them here into some of the different things that they can fall into. So such as rapport building in blue, interviewee-led open-ended questions, and tell me that, and thanks and encouragement questions, and yeah, so thank you, etc. So if we take a look at some of these examples and see what's happening when these words are used. So first of all, explanation of the interview structure. So before we do that, I'd just like to explain everything to me. I'd like you to explain them to me. Thanks for that. I'd just like to go over a few details. Praise, explanation, and establishing roles. So what I've got to do now is break that so that the interviewer is explaining their own role in the interviewer. and establishing rapport. So one of those questions in the form before was, did they ask for a term of address? And it was, can I just ask you what you prefer me to address you at? Demonstrated active listening. So I'll be taking notes. I will be making notes, I will sit back. All of the information will be coming from you, so they're saying, just because I'm not saying anything, I'm still going to be listening. And this also crosses over with the establishing roles technique, so it's the officers telling the interviewee what to expect and in their role and within the interview. Establishing the threshold of the reporting, so how much detail to give. Demonstrating active listening. So I promise to stay silent as much as I can and try not to interrupt you. So again, it's also saying, you know, the interview is going to be led by the interviewer. Enhancing memory retrieval. Also, if you close your eyes and try to picture them, so this is a recommended method of improving memory retrieval, I believe. And also trying to determine the accuracy of reporting, setting the threshold of reporting. So if there's things you can't remember, or what colour, if you remember, so you know, only tell me if you can remember. Explaining the interview structure. So if we just have the physical description initially, so then that could be part of the structure of a series of questions where they go into more detail. So the evidence of rapport building. So they're asking how to address them. Do you mind if I call you Alexandra? Enhancing memory retrieval. So again, it's that idea of picturing the person or the incident in their mind. Demonstrating active listening. So I can just get this into my mind. I've talked about the shop. And that's also sort of single clarification. So again, we hope that'd be part of the multi-term sequence where it's starting with an open question and then the police officers following it up. And then setting the threshold of reporting again. You're not quite sure that's absolutely fine. Establishing the role, so opportunity to ask questions so that you're clear on what would be required of you. Encouragement, interviewee-led interview, and absolutely nothing about this incident, so whatever you tell me. So all of those are setting the expectations of the interviewee. There are some crossovers here. You can see all three of these examples would go to all three of those categories. Really. So what am I saying? Those functions. So showing interviewee-led. Questions, so tell me everything that I need to know or that you think I should know. Summarising the interviewee's words, so you then said the tool one awards the cashier. Right, so you didn't see a knife in anybody's hands. So that's making sure they're referring back to what the interviewee has actually said rather than leaving the question. Showing empathy. And when he shouted that, how did it make you feel? That last question is a little bit odd, because you know, gathering information about the events or etc. is a bit different to how that makes you feel. So I wonder about the suitability of that question. But it does show empathy. And then the topics and sequence of topics is being interviewee led. So we'll start with whatever you want to do first and then let me know. So in your own time, in your own words, just want to tell me what's happened, okey-dokey. So these are the kind of things that you can see happening within the interviews after the training. And these are all very positive. It shows that the training seems to be having a positive effect. You can see it still requires a deal of interpretation to get from the keywords to the examples. So perhaps we can see the phraseology used might be more immediately revealing. And that's something that Andrew will mention now.
So, we've just presented two of the techniques that we use, and this is the third one. But before I go into this one, I just wanted to wrap up what we've just tried to say. So, cops linguistic tools can be effective for kind of a quick assessment of the interviewing strategies. And we've presented word lists, which is just the kind of basically it's just a word list, and keywords. So we compared the before corpus and after corpus, and the significant words in the after corpus were especially based around not just the facts, but also proper building techniques, moral questions, more organizational kind of things that are happening in the structure, explaining the structure of interviews. So in the after corpus, we've got many more of these things going on. So that is a positive effort of the training. Now, lots of other methods that we could use in corpus linguistics, but another one that we wanted to present is the use of engrams. Engrams are multi-word sequences, so we can have two-grams, so sequences, two words, three-gram sequences, three words, four words, five words, and so on. For the purposes of this presentation, we chose three-grams in before and after subcorpora. And what's interesting, what's important is that the engrams, three-grams, support the previous findings from the keywords analysis. What we'll see in yellow and orange is the closed questions. Now, if we just focus on closed questions, obviously, closed questions are absolutely fine towards the ending of the topic, but we wouldn't want to start the topic with closed questions because that is the sign of the interviewer-led. So from this, we don't know where the closed questions occur. So things like, did you see, do you know, do you think, and did you see, do you know, and so on. But just from the frequency, we can see that the frequency is much higher here in the before corpus than it is in the after corpus. So again, it is a positive sign, but obviously we would need to investigate that further. So the frequency of closed questions reduced, and then we just wanted to show you two examples for other things, like, for instance, anything like that. So how anything like that is used. It's in the before corpus, it is predominantly used for clarifying questions. So closed questions, marks, scars, tattoos, gold teeth, anything like that. That's the main function. But also a few questions which could potentially be considered as leading questions. Okay, and did she look distressed at all or anything like that? Which is more of a leading question. But in the after corpus, the number of clarifying questions with anything like that reduces significantly, and there are more questions for building rapport or expressing concern for the witness's welfare. So things like, do you want to drink or anything like that? Any vulnerability or anything like that? Would you feel vulnerable? And another one is you don't. It's something that stuck out in the corpus, so we wanted to explore that a bit more in detail. And again, in the before corpus, you don't is used mainly to summarize statements on behalf of the witness. So you, and it also has this kind of negative connotation, whereas in the after corpus, it is used in a different function, in the function of explaining and establishing the threshold of reporting. So if you don't know, just say you don't know, which is very different from the previous examples. It's important that you say no, or you say you just don't know the answer, and so on. So just to wrap it up, there are some advantages, but also disadvantages of using corpus linguistics. If we focus just on advantages, it's much, much less time consuming. You remember at the beginning of the presentation, I showed you all the coding sheets that they originally used, obviously these corpus linguistic tools. It's much less time consuming. It's more objective and it's more language driven, so the influence of the researcher is not as significant. And it could you could combine quantitative and qualitative types of analysis. We would also, as I said at the beginning, we only looked at the questions from the linguistic point of view. It's not ideal, so we would like to explore now how the function of questions and the responses interact and how that would compare. There are lots of other things that we could do as well. Perhaps what is interesting for me is the role of corpus linguistics in investigative interviewing research, and also corpus linguistic tools, sort of semi-automated coding of interviews for practitioners and forensic psychologists, and how those could be used in practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions?
Yeah, your bottom bullet point really, where are you now with that? Have you launched that into practice anywhere or?
We're collecting data at the point. So we just need to have more interviews, real interviews, not just interviews with mock witnesses. And then we started thinking about developing some tools. So I feel that we're in a good point, but we definitely need more interviews for that. Maybe I'm a bit over optimistic.
Any more questions?
Yeah, I was wondering whether it's kind of related to that, actually. Have you got plans for disseminating this kind of information for the corpus linguistics interview? Is there any plans for that?
I feel it would be great, but this is the first time we presented it, so we need to write an article about that first and do more research before we actually take it.
What software did you use?
Some custom built software in this case, some scripts I wrote, but there is some software out there that used to do course linguistics like Wordsmith, which some of you will know Mike Scott because he's part of Aston University, he developed Wordsmith and AmpConf as well.
Thank you very much.